A.
Mozart realised, like his great predecessor Monteverdi, that music drama could be the vehicle for a powerful message. By choosing to set this as an opera, Mozart was deliberately courting controversy and entering a political arena.
This is the Britain Theatre in London, where students of the Royal College and Royal Academy of Music Opera Course are rehearsing a production of that same opera. The Marriage of Figaro is about a count who is trying to use his position to deflower a young internee, maid, who works in his household. The girl in question, Susanna, is about to get married to the Count's valet, Figaro. Susanna is also maid and close confidant of the Countess, the Count's exasperated wife. In this scene, the Count and Susanna are trying to arrange a secret rendezvous later that night in the bushes. On the surface of it, it's a merry roister-doister of a sexual farce. But beneath the skin, this opera is about the rich and powerful treating their employees like slaves and playthings. And no one who saw it at the end of the 18th century with Europe on the brink of political implosion would have had any doubt whatsoever about its message. And that includes the Emperor Joseph shifting uneasily in his royal box.
What is doubly significant, though, is that the servants ultimately outwit and humiliate their master, and at the end of the opera, this once omnipotent count is forced to kneel in humble apology to his wife in front of his whole household. At this moment of sublime music, it is as if the Ancien Régime itself is bowing to the inevitable and submitting to the greater will of its subjects.
Thank you.
Mozart's masterpiece is hardly provocative by today's standards, but in the 1780s it was a shocking foretaste of the revolutions that were about to engulf Europe.
In 1789, Camille Desmoulins leapt onto a café table in Paris shouting, to arms, and calling all French patriots to liberate themselves from the slavery of monarchy. One of the first acts of the hysterical mob was to storm the prison that had become a potent symbol of repression, La Bastille. Here, where once echoed the cries of torment and anguish, now stands the lavish new Opéra de la Bastille.
The storming of the Bastille triggered the revolution, and it also became the inspiration for a whole wave of populist operas.
The recurring theme of these operas was escape and deliverance from unjust imprisonment. Composers and librettists, who before the revolution had acted as the conscience of the aristocratic ruling elite, soon became the conscience of the new bourgeois regime with these so-called rescue operas. As in Dickens's A Tale of Two Cities, these operas call for a universal compassion across the classes, with many of their heroes and heroines being good aristocrats caught up in a general terror. And the most famous of all these rescue operas is, of course, Beethoven's Fidelio.
Fidelio, Beethoven's only opera, premiered in 1806. It's set in a prison, and the allusion to revolutionary Paris is unambiguous. Whilst the plot concerns the successful release from unjust imprisonment of a good man, what really interests Beethoven is the generalized theme of liberation and deliverance. It ends with a passionate hymn to freedom. And ever since, the piece has been associated with the overthrowing of tyranny. After the end of hostilities in 1945, opera houses all over Europe reopened with Fidelio.
The French Revolution may have begun with the storming of the Bastille, but the Belgian Revolution of 1830 was actually triggered by an event during an opera performance. No, really, it's true.